Well, welcome to or welcome back to the 510 Report, where we talk about industry news, advocacy, and general goings-on. Thank you so much for joining me again. The first thing I wanted to mention this week definitely falls in the general goings-on category. Matt Cully over there at the Suck My Mod YouTube has started his live Monday night interview series. He's already interviewed people like Tony Abood from the VTA, as well as Brian from the Vapor Chronicles, and most recently he had on Aaron Biebert, the director of the You Don't Know Nicotine movie we talked about last week. I would highly recommend tuning into the live stream or at least catching the replay of these interview videos because they are great. So huge shout out to Matt for changing things up and doing something really helpful and really constructive for the cause. Now the first like news story that I wanted to talk about, easily the most discussed topic of last week, this new study out of the UK. And it was such big news, it got picked up by a lot of mainstream media news outlets, which when good news comes out of England, whether that's reports or studies or news articles, it's very, very rare that it gets picked up by that many mainstream media outlets. NBC News picked it up, The Washington Post picked it up, but today I'm going to be using the New York Times article, which has the big headline on it. E-cigarettes are effective at helping smokers quit, a study says. Now, to a lot of people watching this video, this is going to seem like a real big, well, yeah, duh moment, but the importance of this news cannot be overstated. Large portions of the population in the United States of America still believe that vaping is just as bad or more harmful than burning combustible tobacco cigarettes, perpetuated in large part by the misinformation machine being run by FDA Commissioner Scott Gottlieb. But we have this data right here, plain as day. In a year-long randomized study in the United Kingdom, 886 currently addicted adult smokers were either randomly given a vapor product to attempt to quit smoking or a pharmaceutical NRT product to attempt to quit smoking. NRT products like gums, patches, and sprays. The subjects were also given weekly counseling sessions on top of this. At the end of the study, 9.9% of the group that was given NRT products was able to quit successfully, and 18% of the people given vapor products were able to quit successfully. Now I know that I'm math A over here, but unless I'm reading this wrong, it almost seems like vapor products are twice as effective as traditional pharmaceutical NRT products for quitting smoking. Throw any backhanded commentary you want into this article, New York Times, but those numbers don't lie. Peter Hayek, the lead author of this study and professor of clinical psychology at Queen Mary University in London, said health professionals have been reluctant to recommend their use because of the lack of clear evidence from randomized controlled trials. This is now likely to change. I can only hope that that's true, Professor Hayek. I personally receive dozens and dozens of emails from viewers and subscribers telling me their story of their doctors trying to convince them that vaping is bad for them and that they would be better off smoking. I've said this before and I'm assuming I'll say it again, but if you are against vapor products, you are against public health. This study shows that. Hundreds of studies have shown that. Unfortunately, at the time of this recording, all the links that I could track down to this study that was published in the New England Journal of Medicine kind of just come up with this error screen. So if anybody watching has a working link to the study, I would love it if you dropped it down in the comments below. I'll be linking down in the description as well to this particular New York Times article. I would encourage everybody watching to read it, absorb it, and just share it to as many people as you can. It is a little bit ironic though that I picked the New York Times article because at that time I felt like the New York Times was maybe the most trustworthy news source out of all of the mainstream media news sources that picked up this article. But even in this article they say, e-cigarettes provide the nicotine smokers crave without the toxic tar and carcinogens that come from inhaling burning tobacco, but regulators in the United States, Britain, and elsewhere have not approved them to be marketed as smoking cessation tools. Remember that it's not necessarily fake news, it's just incorrect news or false news. While it might be true that in the United States, our backward and corrupt public health officials have not recommended vaping as a form of smoking cessation, but The Guardian reported just last month that Public Health England is doing a public awareness campaign in order to to switch as many smokers as possible over to less harmful vapor products. MPs in the United Kingdom are currently urging Parliament to relax the currently in place regulations on vapor products in order to make them more accessible to people. Public Health England also made a series of videos in order to educate the public about the perceived risks or benefits from using less harmful vapor products. And hospitals across the UK now have designated vaping areas on property for people and patients to use. So I'm sorry, the New York Times, but that is just blatantly false information. And the next thing I wanted to mention, which was only brought to my attention a few hours ago, is this incredibly sad story out of Texas and a man named William Brown. According to the New York Post, William Brown was rushed to the ER where he passed away just 2 days later from injuries sustained from when his vape pen exploded near his face. I'm only using the vape pen terminology because that's what the article is using. The particular device that William Brown was using in this situation hasn't been disclosed. He was driving in a car at the time, and the article says it happened in such a way that pieces of the vape pen severed his internal carotid artery. Investigators told Brown's grandmother that the battery was directly responsible for his death. Now, this is just a really tricky topic to cover. I can't imagine the heartbreak that William Brown's family is going through right now due to this freak accident. And it irritates me to no end that news outlets will take a sad story like this and then use it to push their anti-vaping agenda. It kind of makes me sick. We call that logical fallacy the appeal to emotion. This article uses this poor man's death to push the idea that this is widespread and something we definitely need to be panicking about. There's even a quote from the poor man's grandmother saying, "I hope, if anything, I hope it stops someone from smoking electronic cigarettes. I don't know how many more people will have to die." They list U.S. Fire Administration statistics stating that between 2009 and 2016, there were 133 reported cases of injuries from vaporizers malfunctioning or other similar devices. I don't know exactly what they mean by other similar devices. They could be referring to the Samsung Galaxy Note 7 that was recalled in 2016 for also exploding, causing fires and injuries. My heart truly goes out to William and William's family, and as sad as this story is, and it is sad, but as sad as this story is, it is really an isolated incident. According to the National Fire Protection Association, through the date range similar as listed above between 2009 and 2014, there was over 100,000 home and structure fires caused by cigarettes and over 3,000 human deaths related to those fires. 133 injuries over the course of 7 years with tens of thousands of users worldwide, it's almost a statistically irrelevant number. William Brown is now the second known person to have been killed from an exploding or malfunctioning vapor product. The first being a Florida man that was killed almost exactly a year earlier. Batteries are dangerous. All batteries are dangerous. Product safety, and battery education are all critically important things. If you're going to use a mechanical vape device, or any vape device for that matter, do your due diligence. Learn how it works. If you don't know, just ask. Ask me, ask other YouTubers, ask your local brick and mortar shop. Learn as much as you can. Protect your batteries, store them, and use them, and charge them in a safe manner. You certainly wouldn't just jump on a motorcycle with no previous experience, no instruction, and no education, and just attempt to tear off towards the highway. And the same thing goes for this technology. Education and common sense are critical. Like I said, my heart goes out to William and his family. I can't possibly imagine what they're going through right now. I don't know if any of this could have been avoided with maybe a little more information and education given William's way. We're past that point now, and all we can do is move forward and keep educating people about battery safety and how to properly use vaporizers. So this very last thing that I wanted to mention is actually an answer from the question and answer site Quora. If you don't know, Quora is a lot like Yahoo Answers. People ask questions, Other people give answers. If you're a member of the Quora community, then you get to upvote or downvote answers based on what you feel is correct for any particular given question. The idea is that the most correct or accurate answer will be voted to the top. Well, last year on Quora, the question was asked, why is vaping now more dangerous than smoking cigarettes? 13 people replied, giving various answers, some better than others, but one of them, Marion Burt, the former programmer, tech writer, and retired ESL instructor, kind of hit the nail on the head, and I'd like to share that answer with you right now if I could. The answer is a little longer than you think, but it's also not as long as you think. It's certainly dangerous to big tobacco companies as more and more people stop buying tobacco cigarettes after switching to vaping. It's certainly dangerous to the pharmaceutical industry as people stop buying nicotine patches and gum, inhalers, and drugs and switch to vaping instead. Also, they get fewer illnesses that are a result of smoking, and so they need less medicine. It is certainly dangerous to the governments that rake in huge amounts of money in taxes on cigarettes and, in some cases, the master settlement with the tobacco industry. Those who don't spend that money on helping people quit smoking or the cost of treatment for smoking-related diseases are in a whoops situation and are worried that they won't have it for whatever they've used it for. It's certainly dangerous to people whose careers are in the field of tobacco control because as smokers quit and switch to vaping, they won't have any work. Already, you see them spending less time and money on smoking cessation and more on casting doubt on vaping. It's certainly dangerous to public health organizations that receive funding from the pharmaceutical industry because as more people vape and realize it's a lot safer than smoking, they lose respect for organizations who tell lies about vaping in order to obey their pharmaceutical masters and continue to receive money from them. It's certainly dangerous for scientists who want to do constructive, honest research but who are compelled to compromise their integrity by performing dishonest tests or misrepresenting the results of their research to support one of the groups mentioned above. It's certainly dangerous to members of the press who find easy headlines and scare stories about how dangerous vaping is. As more people realize the truth, that vaping saves lives, journalists will have to actually examine studies to ensure that their conclusions are valid for the data and that the press release is an accurate report of the findings. Yes, vaping is pretty dangerous to a lot of people. The only people who aren't in danger are the smokers who become vapers and the people around them. Fantastic answer. And on that note, I think that's where we're going to end the 510 report this week. But we can't end the 510 report without also mentioning kasa.org. Go and sign up. It's right there. It's free and easy. I'll have a link in the description. All you need is an email if you want to know about possible negative vape legislation coming up in your particular city, state, or area. Kasa.org. Follow those calls to actions. And just on a real quick personal note, I just want to thank everybody for the love that the 510 report has been getting. It's far and away the least popular video that I do on my YouTube, but I also feel like it's the most important video I do on my YouTube. I'm not doing this for any sort of notoriety or lots and lots of views. All I've ever wanted to do with the 510 report is get as much news out there as I possibly can and hopefully educate some people along the way. I would really appreciate it if you hit that like button down there. It's something I never ask for. And honestly, anywhere that you can share these videos where you think it might be applicable, I would be very much appreciative of that. We're not slowing down anytime soon. We've got a long way to go, you guys. And as Kevin Skipper always said, you don't have to do everything, but you do have to do something. Let's get involved.